In the long history of animal evolution, various extinction events have occurred frequently. Among them, there were 17 minor extinction events. We previously mentioned events like the Carboniferous rainforest collapse, the Olson extinction event, the Carnian pluvial event, and the Paleocene, Eocene, thermal maximum, etc., all of which are considered minor extinction events. Interested individuals can watch these videos. There were also four major extinction events. These include the late Ordovician mass extinction, the late Devonian mass extinction, the end Triassic mass extinction, and the Cretaceous Paleogene mass extinction. When examining these extinction events, we find that they resulted in widespread death on Earth, causing a change in the dominant species at the top of the food chain. However, even more terrifying than all these extinction events is the only great extinction event in the history of animal evolution. This event, known as the Permian-Triassic mass extinction or the Great Dying, this mass extinction event wiped out 95% of all species on Earth. So, what was the exact cause of this horrific catastrophe endured by life on Earth? In simple terms, more than 250 million years ago, as a result of continental drift, all the continents on Earth were connected together, forming a vast supercontinent known as Pangaea. Due to frequent collisions between tectonic plates, Earth experienced its most active period of volcanic activity since the dawn of life on the planet. Eventually, around 260 million years ago, the tension on Earth reached its limit, leading to a cataclysmic event. The first wave of devastation occurred near what is now known as Mount Emei, in what is roughly present-day China. A series of supervolcanoes in this region suddenly erupted, spewing massive amounts of magma. In an instant, they obliterated everything within 100 miles, turning the area into a hellish landscape. After the flowing magma cooled, it solidified into dark basalt, leaving behind layers of black rock in the Earth's crust that tell the story of this once hellish scene. This large-scale volcanic activity is known as the Emishan Traps. Such a level of volcanic activity in any era would be sufficient to trigger a rare and massive extinction event. However, this was just the prologue to a greater catastrophe at the end of the Permian period. 9 million years after the dark rock event at Mount Emei, even more violent volcanic activity erupted in what is now Siberia, known as the Siberian Traps. This event finally pushed the majority of life on this planet into an irreversible abyss of hell. If there had been an extraterrestrial observer near Earth at that time, they would have witnessed a profoundly terrifying sight. The planet would have appeared like a colossal corpse suspended in space, its surface torn apart as if by the hand of the grim reaper. Red-hot lava resembled thick, viscous blood slowly flowing from the massive wound in Siberia. Simultaneously, the acrid stench of death and thick smoke permeated the entire atmosphere, plunging the entire planet into a deathly silence. In this unending inferno, the lava was just the first wave of disaster. What truly exterminated life was the volcanic emission of sulfur dioxide. The sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere reacts with oxygen and water to form sulfuric acid, which then falls to the ground as what is known as acid rain. This alone is not enough. Sulfuric acid also contaminates the soil and groundwater, rendering the land barren for decades. However, sulfur dioxide brings about a third wave of devastation. It induces an opposite effect to carbon dioxide, creating an ice house effect. Suddenly, the entire globe is covered in ice and sea levels plummet. To bring this doomsday judgment to a close, volcanoes offer another deadly gift, carbon dioxide. As sulfur dioxide gradually depletes, carbon dioxide takes the upper hand. On the one hand, high concentrations of carbon dioxide themselves can lead to carbon dioxide suffocation in animals. On the other hand, the intense greenhouse effect causes a sharp rise in global temperatures, plunging the world's ocean currents into turmoil. Chaotic currents churn up decaying organic matter from the seafloor sediments, which, under the influence of bacteria, rapidly deplete the oxygen in the seawater. After the Grim Reaper passed through, only an empty Pangaea remained, scorching hot and desolate. In most regions, the majority of life was on the brink of complete extinction. Coral reefs and forests had become distant legends. In certain marine areas, even stromatolites, constructed by algae and bacteria, had reappeared. It was as if one had momentarily traveled back to the dawn of life's birth. However, for some unknown reason, there were still a few animals that managed to survive this apocalyptic catastrophe. In the previous video, we mentioned how, just before the extinction event, beasts underwent a second revolution in their bodies, evolving new features such as nasal passages and a constant body temperature. The mucus and cilia within these nasal passages could filter out some toxic dust, and this subtle filtration process often meant the difference between life and death in the post-apocalyptic wasteland. Maintaining a constant body temperature became the winning card for these beasts. For every 10-degree increase within a certain range, their physical reactions and strength doubled. At around 37 degrees Celsius, the animal's physical functions reached their peak. A constant body temperature meant that these animals were in a perpetual state of readiness, and in this ever-changing environment, absolute strength equated to absolute survival. At the same time, these resilient beasts went to great lengths to develop various sensory abilities. Part of their facial hair evolved into sensitive whiskers that could detect subtle vibrations in their surroundings. They gradually reduced one part of their upper jawbone and two parts of their lower jawbone to connect with the inner ear and eardrum, enhancing their sense of hearing. Coupled with their already formidable sense of smell, having an additional mode of perception provided an extra layer of security. From then on, no matter how harsh the environment, nothing could prevent our ancestors from finding that tiniest glimmer of hope. And complex perception also brought about demands on the nervous system, while maintaining a warm body temperature ensured the safeguarding of bodily functions. So, our ancestors extended a portion of the two-layered structure of the forebrain into a six-layered structure, giving rise to a revolutionary creation, neocortex. The emergence of the neocortex was akin to adding an advanced processor to the animal brain, resulting in a monumental leap in our ancestors' sensory and cognitive abilities. This laid a solid foundation for the evolution of beasts over the next 200 million years. As a result, many Eutheriodontia, represented by Thrinaxodon, successfully survived the catastrophic event of the major extinction. Throughout this series of trials and tribulations, they developed a new group called Mammalia Morpha. However, in my view, the most profound impact on future animals came from another evolutionary outcome, a strategy chosen independently by both dragons and beasts. That is reducing the number of offspring and increasing the quality of care provided to each one. A member of the dragons, known for producing fewer but larger eggs, began to rise gradually. This group is called archosauriforms. Their eggshells started to become harder, providing excellent protection for the embryos. Inside the eggs, there was a substantial yolk, sufficient to nourish the developing offspring until they were mature enough to cope with this harsh world. Even after the dragon hatchlings had hatched, this group of dragons would sometimes continue to care for their offspring. Compared to that, beasts with lower completeness in their amniotic eggs didn't have such conditions. However, they opted for a different strategy to adapt. On one hand, beasts began to store eggs within their bodies for as long as possible, delaying the formation of eggshells. This approach allowed the mother to absorb the urea produced by the embryos while also providing some nutrients for the developing offspring. 100 million years later, this evolutionary path led to the descendants of the beasts, which are mammals, acquiring viviparity. However, in that era, newly hatched beasts' offspring, by today's standards, were preemies. Nevertheless, some beast mothers began to invest enormous effort in nurturing their offspring, laying the foundation for the later emergence of nursing behavior. As the catastrophic extinction unfolded and wiped out life on Earth, the animals carried a faint sense of warmth and pride as they ventured into a new era. Let the hardships of yesterday nurture the glory of our tomorrow. This is Ancient Discovery. See you in the next video.